अरे वा, निलेश माथुरी इज ऑल्सो जॉइनिंग फ्रॉम सिंगापुर, सॉरी कॅनडा.
सुरू करा शशिकांत आता.
या ओके, गुड इवनिंग ऑल. टुडे वी हॅव शशिकांत वाघमोडे ऑफ 1994 बॅच. He's with Armed Forces. He's working with Army, and he has done a tremendous work during Uttarakhand disaster as well as Kerala disaster. And he was being recognized and awarded with 4 awards. And he does have a lot of exposure to the disaster management activity. So I thought, like, say he will talk and deliver session on disaster management. So Shashi, like, say you can also introduce yourself and take over the charge to deliver the session.
Sure. Thank you.
Sure. Welcome.
I would request everyone to put their mic on the mute. Okay, am I audible and visible?
Yeah.
Visible? Am I audible and visible?
Yeah.
Okay. Good evening to all Ajinkyans. I hope you and your family is fit and fine at home.
Mama, aa gaya.
And let's pray together that our nation and all Ajinkyans are safe from this pandemic. Before coming to the subject, let me introduce myself. I am Shashikant Vaghmode, 1994 batch from Survey House. And recently...
Hello.
Am I audible?
Yeah.
Before starting, let me thank the organizer for giving me such a wonderful opportunity to speak in front of all Ajinkyans on the most important subject, that is disaster management. It's a vast subject, a little different on what you have heard till date, but yes, it's an important subject. I'll try to cover, and I request to mute everybody. I'll try and cover this main outline in next 30 to 35 minutes. For first 20 minutes, I'll give a general idea on what is disaster management, how it is organized, and at various level, what is the modus of operandi. And in last 15 minutes, I'll try and cover on Pune risk analysis.
Mute karna sagayana.
हो केलं होतं, पण काही जण उशिरा आले ना, ते त्यांनी तसंच राहिले. ते एकच मिनिट करतोय मी. हा केलं या कंटिन्यू.
ड्यूरिंग अँड आफ्टर द डिझास्टर बेस्ड ऑन माय एक्सपिरियन्स. एनिवे, द वर्ड वर्ड डिझास्टर इज अ फ्रेंच वर्ड. डिझा मीन्स अ बॅड अँड ॲस्टर मीन्स अ स्टार. Disaster management is an organization which is responsible for planning and application of the measures for preparing, responding to the initial recovery from the disaster. The natural disaster is occurring around the world with a greater ferocity and well as a greater frequency. In next few years, world and India can experience frequent floods, cyclones, earthquake, and biological disaster. So looking at the present scenario, the coronavirus, that is the COVID-19 pandemic, is defining a global health crisis and is going to be the greatest challenge which all are going to face after the World War II. The virus has spread to each and every continent. Cases are rising in 4 figures. Every country is racing to slow the speed of viruses. But then testing the patient, or by carrying out the contacts, or by limiting the travels, or by quarantining the citizens. All the shops, theaters, restaurants, bars, everything is closed. And the world's greatest market is also deserted, either by the choice or by the government order. Every day the people are losing jobs, income, without knowing when the normality will return. Gentlemen, based on the International Labour Organization report, that is 195 million jobs could be lost in the coming months. And today only the World Health Organization's head said that this is a pandemic and has arrived to stay. There is still a long way to go. And many countries are in the initial stage. It has come with three main peculiar characteristics. One is like it has come with a greater speed, greater scale, and a greater severity. So today the world's death figure has crossed around 1,84,000. And gentlemen, since my childhood, I used to think that the human being is a super brain being stepped on the moon, planning to step on the Mars. We are planning to construct a building whose height is going to be more than 1,000 meters, more than Burj Khalifa. We have got a solution for each and every bloody thing in the world. But gentlemen, today the two superpower countries like US and China, whose GDP is around 21.4 trillion and 14.5 trillion, has to literally get on their knees and beg for the life in front of the smallest microorganism. It's very disheartening to see Italian Prime Minister addressing his country with the tears in his eyes. And this shows what is the importance of a disaster management, which is going to play a main role in the future. Now, since this has become a very, very important subject, a lot of international organizations are working on the disaster management, like IFRC, that is the International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Society, which is the world's largest humanitarian organization made of around 186 members, basically to improve the lives of vulnerable people. Then there is something called as IRC, International Committee of the Red Cross. It is a Swiss-based organization. It provides assistance to the people affected by the violence. Then there is something called as UNISDR, that is United Nations International Strategy for Disaster Reduction. And lastly, as you know, that the famous organization, that is the World Health Organization, you have been listening since last 4 months. In 2015, a lot of countries came together and participated in formulating a Sendai framework. A Sendai is basically in Japan, for the disaster risk reduction to reduce the risk for next 15 years. And India was also part of it. If you see, India has got a long history of various disasters. In 1770, great Bengal famine, where 10 million people died in the Bengal and Bihar and Odisha. In 1839, Koringa cyclone in Andhra Pradesh, 20,000 people died. In 1896, third pandemic plague, 12 million people died, mostly from the India and China, that is from Bombay and Calcutta. Tsunami, 2,30,000 people died from 14 countries. Uttarakhand, flat flush, thousands of people got missing. It was actually a worst experience for me, since I was stuck in the Hemkund and later I was shifted to Badrinath before, during and after the disaster. And recently, Kerala flood disaster, which I had opportunity to experience from the day one till the last. Now, gentlemen, as per the statistic, India as a whole is vulnerable to 30 different types of disasters that can hamper our own economy, social and human development for longer terms. If you look at the geographical terrain of our country, we are more prone to the natural disaster than any other country. Like 57% of the land is vulnerable to the earthquake, out of which 12% is vulnerable to the severe earthquake. 68% of land is vulnerable to the drought. 12% is vulnerable to the flood, basically the coastal line and the peninsular line. And apart from all these things, there are a lot of cities which are vulnerable to the man-made disaster like chemical, industrial disaster or terrorist attack. The global studies have shown that the proper planning and preparation can be done to save a life before, during and after the disaster. As per the report published by the Tata Institute of Social Science called Indian Disaster Report Number 2, it states that the poverty is the main concern for the loss of so many lives in India. Like I will give an example, if in a rich country, if 100 people die in a natural disaster of the same ferocity, in India, 5,000 people will die, or India or any poor country, because of the poverty. In a military, there is an old saying, be prepared for the worst and hope for the best. Anyway, the disaster, I would say, it's broadly divided into three phases, pre-impact phase, impact phase, and post-impact phase. under the two main heads, that is natural disaster and man-made disaster. Under the natural disaster, again, there's a water climate disaster, geological disaster, biological disaster, industrial disaster. And under the man-made disaster, it's something like a terrorist attack or nuclear, biological and chemical attack, or attack which has happened on the World Trade Center, or any important attack on the infrastructure or any heritage building. Now, if we speak about the national level, all our policies are designed on the Disaster Management Act 2005, which provides three-tier mechanism. That is, at a national level, at a state level, and at a district level. Now, if you look at the national level, the role is clearly indicated, that is, planning, organizing, coordinating, and implementing the measures which are necessary for the prevention of the disaster. In India, we also have various types of disaster management, like Red Cross, NDRF, paramilitary forces, National Security Guard, and of course, Army, Navy, and Air Force, in case the situation is beyond the control of all above. They all work in a tandem. At a national or state or a district level, there are two main organizations. That is, first is NDMA, that is National Disaster Management Authority. And at the state level, it is called as a SDMA, or a State Disaster Management Authority. And at a district level, it is called as a DDMA. Now, what is the NDMA? NDMA is an apex body for the disaster management, headed by our Honorable Prime Minister, Sri Narendra Modi, as a chairperson, and other members not exceeding more than a 9%, like the person from the atomic, or for the irrigation, or agriculture, or as per his choice. Now, if you look at the state level, Chief Minister is the chairperson of the SDMA, that is State Disaster Management Authority. And in case, if it is a union territory, then Lieutenant Governor is the chairperson. But except Delhi. Delhi is the Chief Minister, is the chairperson. Now, at a district level, the collector or district magistrate is the head of a DDMA, that is District Disaster Management Act. Now, if you look at the Maharashtra in all, that is SDMA, it was constituted in 2006. More or less, all the three organizations have got the same policies, supervision, direction or control, and coordinating with the states. And most important, they approve the plan in accordance with the guidelines laid down as per the National Authority 2005 policy. Now, second one is the NEC, or that called as National Executive Committee at a national level. And at a state level, it is called as a SEC. It is basically to assist the NDMA or SDMA. Now, what is the NEC composed of? It composed of high-profile members from the Government of India. That includes the Union Home Secretary as a chairperson, and few members of agriculture, atomic energy, or a defense, or any civil defense, etc., etc. The same at a state level, that is SEC, State Executive Committee, which is headed by the Chief Secretary. And the role is again the same, to lay down the policy on the disaster management, to approve the national plan. National plan is a key word here. Approve plan prepared by the minister in accordance with the national plan, to lay down the guidelines for the state authorities, and to provide a support to the other countries. Now, as I said, the key word was a national plan. And what is a national plan? If you read in last week's newspaper, recently two doctors have moved to the Supreme Court seeking a formulation of a comprehensive disaster management plan in the face of a COVID-19 pandemic. Well, in fact, our former Union Minister, Mr. Kapil Sibal, had also asked some question to the center, that what is a national plan as per the provision of a National Disaster Management Act, Section 11. Now, what is a national plan? A national plan is a plan drawn for a whole country by the National Executive Committee, that is NEC, keeping in the mind a national policy and in consultation with the state government experts in that particular field. Now, what national plan will have? It will have, it is the same or more or less it is the same at a state plan also, a national plan also. It consists of what? It consists of the measures for the prevention of the disaster, measures to mitigation, measures to be taken in the preparedness in any threatening situation. Or it has got a role of different ministers in such disaster. It is actually supposed to be reviewed and updated every year, which I guess is not done. Maybe because we Indians have got a habit to wake up at the last moment and then run without knowing where we are running. Lastly, in the organization, that is the local authority, which is the lowest organization. Now, local authorities like famous, that is Panchayat Raj Institute, or we call it as a PRI. Municipal corporations, municipal municipalities, then district and town planning authorities. Is associated with the disaster management process. These are the bodies which actually makes the disaster management plan following the guidelines of the national plan. This was what I just gave in what are the organizations at the various level. Now I'll tell you in very short, what are the actual working forces on the ground? One is NDRF. NDRF is National Disaster Response Force at a national level. SDRF is the state level. At a state level, it is called as the SDRF. At a national level, we have a 12 battalions of NDRF consisting of around 1,149 members. They directly come under the chairperson of NDMA, that is our Honorable Prime Minister. And one battalion is of NDRF is posted at Pune. Basically, why Pune? Because we are more concerned with the Maharashtra, which is responsible for whole of the Maharashtra. Now, here, if you see, the time is very, very important after the disaster has occurred. For effective response, and it is difficult for NDRF to respond quickly to the disaster places like Vidarbha, or take it Marathawada, or say Latur. So now there is a proposal for every state to have their own state response, disaster response team, which is a standalone team. Two companies of SDRF will be created in the state on the lines of NDRF. Every company will have three teams. Every team will have 45 members. And every with the additional of around 422 or 28 total members, it will include with the staff, supporting staff, and the field level officers. Now, all this package will be put under the Maharashtra government and a commandant of NDRF. Now, there is something called as a State Emergency Operations Center, that is SEOC at a state level. And at the district level, it is called as a DEOC, that is District Emergency Operations Center. Gentlemen, this is very important because this facilitates, which is a primary establishment at the Mantralay premises at Mumbai. And in case the emergency is there, additional EOC could be established at Pune. Both the EOC will be identical in the function. And the EOC at the Mantralay will work for the 24/7 hours around the year. During the emergency, it should be activated at a full scale with a short time frame of 2 to 3 hours. Now, this standby EOC, which I told will be activated in the Pune, which will come under the Director General Yashoda, who is Mr. Anand Limaya. And he's the IS officer, basically. And it will be supported by the Director CDMA, who is Mr. Vishwas Supnekar. Now, this Mantralay EOC, which is very, very important, will connect to the national EOC and to the all districts 24/7 round the clock. Providing the early warning. Now, coming at the District Emergency Operations Center, that is DEOC, basically it is activated only in case it is a level 1 disaster occurs. And in case it is a level 2, the state emergency operation will be activated with the help of DEOC. Level 3 is a severe, basically severe. Now, what is the function of this at the emergency time? It ensures the passage of the information to Chief Minister, Chief Secretary, Minister of R&R, and State Executive Committee. It also maintains the communication between EOC, districts facing emergencies at the period, and give the feedback to them. Now, here the media management is very, very important given to the EOC. Management of funds, resources, and aids. And being this state EOC is a key communication hub, it comes directly under the secretary at a state level. And at a district level, it comes under the district collector. Now, I think it's very difficult to absorb. So I'll give, for ease of understanding and assimilation, I will give my personal example so that you understand the organization. Now, after studying for last 2 days, I can correlate what was actually happening with me during the Kerala floods. During the Kerala floods, Kerala state received around 116% more rainfall than usual rainfall, which resulted into filling up of all the dams beyond the permissible level. So out of 55 dams, 34 dams had to be opened, and which was including Idukki Dam. Now, gentlemen, if you are aware that Idukki Dam is the Asia's largest dam. So on 14th of August, the Government of India, or a National Disaster Management Authority, declared a calamity of a level 3. That means a severe nature. On the same day, that is on at around 1700 hours, my boss, senior officer, got a call from the chairperson at a state executive committee or a chief secretary, who was that time a Sri Tom Jose, he's an IS officer, very senior IS officer. He requested to send a rescue team to the Idukki district next to the dam area at a location called as Chappat with a reaction time of 3 to 4 hours. Now, since we Ajikens have got a habit of raising a hand, as Dinesh said, before knowing what is the event. So like a true Ajinkyan, I also raised the hand and I volunteered to lead a mixed team of 30 to 35 people comprising deep sea divers, then volunteers from the army, volunteers from the navy and the coast guard. And we were the first to get inducted on that is on the 14th of August. We left at the Kochi at around 2000 hours to Idukki district. Now, if you see that terrain of Idukki, it's a mountainous terrain. It, since it was raining very, very heavy, we come across a lot of landslides, roadblocks, small, small nalas. But here, our target was to cross the Pamba River before 4 a.m. because the gates of Idukki Dam were going to open at 4 a.m. With a great difficulty and challenge, we managed to reach a location given by the chief secretary. After reaching at 4 a.m., I reported to the chairperson of DDMA, that is a collector of Idukki, who was that time was a Sri Jeevan Babu. I cannot forget that person because since he was very docile and very helpful to me. He all the orders which were with him to us to clear the few debris and dead bodies some special task. And after operating for 3 to 4 days near the Idukki, we were told to report to a local body, that is PRI, that is Panchayat Raj Institute, at a Perambudu. There was one village which was totally submerged in the water by fast-flowing river. So we operated for the whole day and rescued many old people, pregnant ladies, and then other children. Again, on the sixth moonless night, we were told to conduct a special emergency operation by the Panchayat Raj Institute, that is PRI. In heavy rains and against the fast flowing rivers, which is globally, which this operation is globally famous. As you know, it is Operation Water Baby, which had come in around 35 newspapers and it has come in the Dubai and Saudi Arabia's newspaper also. You can Google it. Now, gentlemen, why I wanted to narrate this incident just to understand how the chain of the disaster management works from top to bottom. That is from NDMA to SDMA, then SDMA to DDMA, DDMA to PRI. And everyone played an important role in this type of operation. And that is why it was actually a successful operation. Now, if you see how we get the daily updates of a coronavirus twice a day from every corner of the India, all the PRIs collect the data from the villages and they pass to DDMA at a collector or a district level, where he passes to SEC, that is a state level, to the chief secretary. And from chief secretary, it is passed to the NEC, that is a national level, where all the state data is correlated and then it goes to the international level. And that is how we can see a figure on our worldometer on the mobile. It is behind this, it has a very, very Herculean task. A lot of organizations, a lot of agencies are involved in from the grassroots level or the zero level. Now, for your information, gentlemen, let me tell you, that Maharashtra has got around 10 regional disaster management centers, starting from Navi Mumbai, Raigad, then Thane, and next is Pune, Satara, then Sangli, Kolhapur, Sindhudurga, Ratnagiri, Solapur, Usmanabad, Latur, Aurangabad, Jalna, Bid, Nanded, Hingoli, Parbani, Nagpur, Bandara, Gondia, and etc. etc. Now, as I told you, since the majority of the Ajinkyans are from Pune, I'll try and give the overall risk analysis of the Pune based on the book which I have referred. This is a book. This is a book, Integrated Regional Disaster Management Plan for Pune and Pune Municipal Council. I have referred this book and based on this, I'll give you a certain outline. Now, Pune is a city with a 2-district municipal corporation or so-called as Mahanagar Palika, that is PMC and PCMC. The speed of the development of Pune has been tremendous since 1995 because I have been seeing this Pune from 1999. The IT image of the Pune has attracted a population, infrastructure and economy in the last 20 years. Pune has achieved a tremendous development in terms of economic growth, in terms of infrastructure. But on the other side, it has lost its green cover. It has lost its hill. It has lost the air quality. It has lost the groundwater quality. It has lost good quality of rivers. And since, as I told you, I have spent around 4 to 5 years in Pune, I know each and in and out of the Pune. No doubt, Pune is a wonderful city. It has got around 21 rivers. It has got 8 lakes. It has got 14 dams, public reservoirs. It has got around 5,500 institutes, out of which 2,500 are the lower primary, 2,000 are the upper primary, 1,300 are the high schools, 14 are the universities, 31 are the art and science colleges. And since last 10 years, the Pune population has gone up tremendously. It has absolutely doubled. Presently, today, the Pune's population is around 7 million with a density of around 600 people per square kilometer, with a total area of around 729 square kilometers. Gentlemen, let me tell you, it is bigger than Mumbai, because Mumbai has got around 605 square kilometer area. So geographically, if you see the Pune, it lies in the seismic zone number 3. So the chances of affecting area is fairly high. The intensity of the earthquake can be around 7 to 7.5 Richter scale in place like Bhor, Daun, Lonawala. The practice of the bad construction on the hilly terrain has loosened up the soil and can lead to a landslides like Uttarakhand. There is susceptibility of epidemics of contagious disease like airborne, waterborne disease due to the various reasons. The main reason I will tell you that is lack of hygiene and inappropriate solid waste management collection and disposal of waste. The risk due to the biological hazard in the is fairly high in industrial area like Alandi, Baramati, Bhur, Junnar, Rajgurunagar. Now, after this pandemic, COVID-19, the PMC has opened 2 small rooms on fifth floor and third floor of old PMC building. This is just for your information, which they have turned into a war room to battle against the COVID-19. Various types of committees have been formed in the Pune, like Pune City Disaster Management Committee, Pune City Technical Cell, Pune City Advisor Committee, and of course, Incident Response Team, which is located near the collector office. Now, gentlemen, what I want to tell, that what are the measures been taken at a district level, that is at the Pune level. Now, the PCMC has allotted different safe areas at various different places or various assembly points for the earthquake. It has also allotted the open areas for the flood. There is something called as a red line area or buildings which are the strong. In case of the bomb blast or a terrorist attack, that is actually the place. That is a safe area is around 500 meters from the affected area. Now, what is this preparedness based on? It is based on clearly on a risk assessment and vulnerability of the mapping. By understanding and increasing the trend of the disaster in Pune, by protecting and critical infrastructure like tactical building, heritage building, or the buildings which have got a lot of data or the maps, or by preparing for the climatic changes adaptation, like Corona came in the winter and now it is going in summer, and from summer it is going to in a monsoon season. By improving the awareness of the community through the various medias, by placing information board at all places, basically public places, by holding the exhibition or a clay model of the city indicating the disaster, major disaster and the hazards, by asking the educational institute, corporates, industrial areas, industries to prepare their own disaster management plan, by installing the early warning system for the flood of or earthquake between the irrigation department and to the collector office, or from collector office to the PMC. By disaster management plan for the hospital will also include developing and training of the medical teams and paramedics. I don't know whether it is true or false, but I heard that the Maharashtra government has trained around 4,000 Anganwadi and home guards for the duties of the paramedics. By upgrading the bed capacity in all the government and the private hospitals or in the big institute or in the defense areas, by arranging or attaching a private practitioners or medical colleges students to the various hospitals during the emergency, by identifying the places which are ad hoc hospital can be established, like your pavilions, your auditoriums, your movie halls, can be converted into the mass casualty rooms or mass testing labs. Gentlemen, I want to bring one very important point that you must be aware that Indus Health Plus, owned by one of our Ajinkyan, Mr. Amol Naikudi, he's a 1994 batch, has opened a lab in Pune and Mumbai with a partnership with ICMR for conducting the test for COVID-19. We are very lucky. We all can explore that wonderful facility in case it is required. Now, due to the dearth of time, I'll skip the recovery measures and rehabilitations. And I'll come to the things to do during a national disaster. This is very important thing which we actually require to do. Rest all what I was speaking on the national level, international level, that's it. They will do work on their own. But this is what is required as a layman or as a common man, I have to do, based on my experience. Now, most important is, gentlemen, do not panic. That is, do not panic. If you get panic, till date, no one in this world has done any productive work by getting panicked. Being the senior member of your house, if you get panicked, your whole family will get panicked. Secondly, do not ignore any official or government advice in such cases. All advices are well planned and are coming from the previous experience or from the experts. Or if PM says thali bajao ya tali bajao, diya jalao, to jalao yaar, what's nuksan kya hoga? What's going from your pocket? In fact, it's going to build a confidence in your kids, in your old parents, and it will give a hope to stay alive in such type of situation. Thirdly, plan for a safety. Now, plan for safety, it sounds a little odd, but very much required. In case of an earthquake, what will be my reaction? What will be my wife's reaction? What will be my elder daughter's reaction? Who will exit from which door? Which will be our assembly point? All these things you need to plan in advance. In case if I get affected by corona, what is our action? Which will be our isolation room? Which door I will use in case I'm infected? And fourth is, in case of a communication failure, how will I react? Because gentlemen, whatever I have seen the disasters, the main factor is the communication failure. Let me give you guys most live example which I faced. You won't believe. During Kedarnath Badrinath flash flood, I had gone there for a trekking to the Hemkund on 12th of June. And this disaster took place on 16th of June. And we got stuck in one of the very small place that is called Gagaria. It was very challenging for us to survive. Place where we were camping, the first day that the locals we were there, they provided us dal roti. The second day, they just provided dal and rice. And third day, this local all vanished. We had to manage a food of our own. There was no electricity. There was no mobile range. There was no potable water. All the roads were disrupted. There was no rescue helicopter since all weather was packed up. All civilians were crying, creeping and dying. Life was absolutely miserable. Believe me, gentlemen, it's absolutely chaos in such situation. And let me tell you, when the helicopter came for the rescue, all thousands of the civilians were rushing to jump inside the helicopter when the helicopter's capacity was just 5 members. This is the actual situation which will happen in case this is a disaster. Now, fifth is plan for some good quality of time with your kids and family. Gentlemen, let me tell you from my best, from my own experience. This is actually a time when we are with the kids for the maximum time. In fact, myself, I've been for last 30 days, day and night, I've been kids. Don't scold or pressurize your kids. They're also undergoing a tremendous trauma or a lockdown. But yes, use this time as a golden time for their development. Share your good memories, share your good ideas, share your good experiences, share your good school experiences. That is the best thing which one can share. And lastly, that is, keep on speaking to the all friends, to your parents. Spread a lot of positive energy. Now, this is what was the during the disaster. But what after the disaster? Now, after the disaster, what is the best things you can do? stay away from the disaster area unless and until the local authorities request you to volunteer. And if in case they request you, carry your own clothes, your own food, your own sleeping gear. Second way is to help by donating money. But keep it to yourself only. Need not publicize on the group that I am donating around 50,000 or I am donating 20 lakhs. It's your personal wish. Everybody doesn't have that capacity to donate as you are doing it. Second is put in all your resources. Arrange a fundraiser in your community, in your society. If you are so concerned about the donation, arrange it. Arrange a small fundraiser in your society by various means. Like you can have a small exhibition in your society. You can have a band concert. Gentlemen, let me tell you, I was just going through the news. The Farah Khan, the famous lady, you must be aware. Her daughter, she's just 12 years old. And she has contributed around 70,000 2 days before by making the sketch of the pets for these three animals during this lockdown. Next is the donate blood or plasma. Gentlemen, Mr. Kejriwal has already started this practice in Delhi. I don't know whether he started in the Maharashtra. But if time comes, donate, because the time will come on you also. But lastly, you should be very, very careful by donating the items like clothes or ration. I'll tell you the experience in Kerala floods. Maharashtra government had sent a ship container with a full of 20 tons of dal, rice, atta. It was a little late. Like items like mosquito repellents and important like sanitary napkins also, which literally we have to force with the people of Kerala to accept, because already the houses were in the shambles. They're not able to keep this ration in their house. We have to force them to take this ration because the ration had left reached a little late. So while you donate, be very, very careful that because it's a sentimental issue, donation. So be careful on this thing. Next is help those who need a special assistance. Like an old home age or a widow or any handicap institute. Just help them if they require. Check the government website. That's more important. Gentlemen, stay tuned to your local medias. Keep yourself away from the fake news or the community-related news. These messages which are floating related to community, just keep yourself away from all this. Educate. We are the educated class. We should all curtail these types of message and these forwards. Shashikant Damchetti, I hope there is a time.
2 minutes.
How many minutes?
Two minutes.
Never. Is it 35 minutes or 40 minutes?
No. Let's say 2 minutes for 40 minutes.
Oh, really? Okay, yeah. Okay. Then I think I should wind up. I was going to talk about the biological disaster or biological terrorist.
You can continue. Attacks. You can continue. Let's say.
No, but it's a really important chapter. If you allow me, I'll continue.
Yeah, you continue.
We have one more session. We will have one more session later, I think.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. If you say I'll discontinue. If you say I'll continue, there's no problem. Whether I to continue or not continue.
Continue.
Oh, great. Thank you very much. Shashikant, mera name type, and it's that is my privilege. Gentlemen, this is since I had an opportunity to do a nuclear biochemical warfare course in 2003 in the famous institute in Pune. So I'll try and put across a few important points. Now, what is a biological disaster? It's a natural or man-made disaster or scenario involving a disease or disability or a death due to microorganism like virus, bacteria, or a toxin. Or it can be a man-made attack, basically to generate social paralysis to the mass terrorism or to create a confusion or disruption in the community. Now, here the primary role is with the state government, since it's a health matter. But in case of a biological warfare, that is the use of a biological agent or any act of warfare, then it comes under the Ministry of Home Affairs or Health. Now, countries like US has already passed the Bioterrorism Act in 2002. Unfortunately, India, our nation, we don't have any such policy on bio disaster. Let us pray it get passed as early as possible. Anyway, now looking at the today's scenario, we should